together in singing the opening hymn.
Thank you. A reading from Exodus. The Lord said to Moses, "Go down at once. Your people, whom you brought up from the land of Egypt, have acted perversely. They have been quick to turn aside from the way I commanded them. They have cast for themselves an image of a calf, and have worshipped it, and sacrificed to it, and said, 'These are your gods, O Israel, who brought you up from the land of Egypt.'" The Lord said to Moses, "I have seen these people, how stiff-necked they are. Now let me alone, so that my wrath may burn hot against them, and I may consume them, and of you I will make a great nation." But Moses implored the Lord his God, and said, "O Lord, why does your wrath burn hot against your people, whom you brought out of the land of Egypt with great power and with a mighty hand? Why should the Egyptians say, 'It was with evil intent that he brought them out to kill them in the mountains and to consume them from the face of the earth'? Turn from your fierce wrath, change your mind, and do not bring disaster on your people. Remember Abraham, Isaac, and Israel, your servants, how you swore to them by your own self, saying to them, 'I will multiply your descendants like the stars of heaven, and all this land that I have promised I will give to your descendants, and they shall inherit it forever.' And the Lord changed his mind about the disaster he had planned to bring on the people." The word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
Please join me in the responsive reading. "Have mercy on me, O God, according to your steadfast love. It was your great compassion, in your great compassion, blot out my offenses.
Wash me through and through from my wickedness, and cleanse me from my sin. For I know my offenses, and my sin is ever before me. Against you only I have sinned and done what is evil in your sight. So you are justified when you speak and right in your judgment. Indeed, I was born steeped in wickedness, a sinner from my mother's womb. Indeed, you delight in truth deep within me, and would have me know wisdom deep within. Remove my sins with hyssop, and I shall be clean. Wash me, and I shall be purer than snow. Let me hear joy and gladness, that the body you have broken may rejoice. Hide your face from my sins, and blot out all my wickedness.
Create me a clean heart, O God,
and renew a right spirit within me."
A reading from 1 Timothy. "I am grateful to Christ Jesus our Lord, who has strengthened me, because he judged me faithful and appointed me to his service. Even though I was formerly a blasphemer, a persecutor, and a man of violence. But I received mercy because I had acted ignorantly in unbelief. And the grace of our Lord overflowed for me with the faith and love that are in Christ Jesus. The saying is sure and worthy of full acceptance, that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners, of whom I am the foremost. But for that very reason, I received mercy, so that in me, as the foremost, Jesus Christ might display the utmost patience, making me an example to those who would come to believe in him for eternal life. To the King of the ages, immortal, invisible, the only God, be honor and glory forever and ever. Amen." Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
Lays it on his shoulders and rejoices.
And when he comes home, he calls together his friends and neighbors, saying to them, "Rejoice with me, for I have found my sheep that was lost." Just so, I tell you, there will be more joy in heaven over one sinner who repents than over 99 righteous persons who need no repentance. Or what woman, having 10 silver coins, if she loses one of them, does not light a lamp, sweep the house, and search carefully until she finds it? When she has found it, she calls together her friends and neighbors, saying, "Rejoice with me, for I have found the coin that I had lost." Just so I tell you, there is joy in the presence of the angels of God over one sinner who repents. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Christ.
And at this time, Chris, are you ready?
I am ready.
All right. I hope everything's okay.
Good morning, church. How are you? I am sorry for my tardiness. We had some work at Mount Lachos this morning, and I went back home to change. So, with that, it's so wonderful to be back with you. Pastor Pam asked me to speak about my time at church white assembly. As most of you know, last month, I got to go to church white assembly as one of our voting members, and it was one of the most spiritual experiences I have had. You see, it's not just you and your synod. You're in a room full of other Lutherans or other people of many, many denominations. And as we go about our day, we get to speak and to interact with lots of people, whether it be at lunch, at dinner, at our services. Every single day there's something new. We did lots of work on behalf of the church. One of the big things was us having mission statements, which we work on here in our local churches, and then we send to our synod, we vote on, and they go on to churchwide. In those, we rebuked the sin of the doctrine of discovery, and many other sinful things that we have caused pain through our church. While these may seem like small things, to many people, these are life-saving measures. We also looked into a lot of the social statements on human sexuality that we have had in our church that are outdated and needed updated to better be inclusive of all of those. And when we say all are welcome, we truly mean all are welcome. One of the themes that kept popping up during this assembly was, what is the Spirit moving you to do? And that was something that really resonated with me. For many of you who may not know me, I have had a long journey of faith. I was a cradle Lutheran, as you would call it. I grew up in the Lutheran Missouri Synod Church. And so it was not always an open and affirming church. And it was not a place where I was always welcomed. And so finding a home congregation that was safe and affirming has always been very, very crucial and important to me. And that's where I found First Lutheran. But when we talk about what does the Spirit move us to do, we can look at inside of our own church. I think of the food pantry, the backpacks, safe space, the pride picnic, all of these different pieces that bring people together, our music program. While so often, I'll quote our Reverend Doctor, that so often sometimes we get caught up in the worshiping of small g God, which is the good old days, we need to really focus on what God and the Spirit are calling and moving us to do. It's not just necessarily how I feel about something, it's what does the Spirit want from us? What is the Spirit calling us to? How can we serve our neighbor? I see the God's Work Our Hands shirts, and on there is the verse from Matthew 25 that really drives this congregation, which is to serve our neighbor, which is not just our neighbor next door, that is every person that we come across. Everyone that you meet every single day is your neighbor, and that is what the Spirit in the Bible call us to do. Another theme that kept popping up was the number 323. There were all the buttons everywhere, and all of us were asking each other, what in the heck are these buttons with 323? What does that mean? If you've ever been to any sort of convention, I can tell you there are always buttons and stickers galore, and we'll never have a shortage of them. That depends. But the word justice is in our Bible 323 times. And as Bob preached about a few Sundays ago, it's not just the justice that we think of nowadays, right? It's biblical justice. It's making sure that people find peace and hope and joy. One of the favorite songs that I love came on, or not came on, but we sang it, sorry, my first Sunday back in my home congregation after traveling to a national pageant and to this conference, and that was the Canticle of Praise. And, the line in it that's my favorite is, my heart shall sing of the day you bring, let the fire of your justice burn, like a whale of tears for the draws near, for the work is about to turn. And I really think that is what the Spirit calls us to do. It calls us to create justice and equality, both in our church and in our home and in our lives, and to care for those who need cared for. So what I would ask the Lord to do, and something I try to do myself, is to reflect every single day in every action that we make. Stop and ask yourself, what is the Spirit calling me to do? What is the Spirit moving you to do? And before you react, just take that breath, take that time, and just wait and see what God and the Spirit actually want from you, and what God and the Spirit are moving you to do.
Thank you so much, Chris. For those of you who might not know, the ELCA is a big denomination. There are over 9,000 churches in the ELCA in our country, and 65 different synods. And a synod is just a smaller breakdown of the large church. We are in the Northern Illinois Synod, and that stretches from Knoxville to Stronghurst and up just this side of the metro Chicago area into the corner, far northwest corner of the state. So it's a big organization, and every 3 years we get to have an annual assembly. And so that is what Chris attended on behalf of our the conference?
Us.
Yes, okay. So we thank you for your participation in that and for bringing the word back. Dear siblings in Christ, grace to you and peace from God our Father and from our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. The lost sheep. We've all heard this story countless times, I'm sure. The lost sheep. Now, this whole story doesn't make any sense from a shepherding perspective, right? Who leaves 99 unattended? That's the outrageousness of this story, because a normal shepherd wouldn't. My dad and I used to go count cattle. We had pastures as far as 3 miles from the house. We'd drive the pickup between, right in the middle of them, and he'd count out his window, and I'd count out my window, and we'd hope that the two numbers added up to what we needed to know. But if there was a cow missing, or a steer, most likely a steer, we wouldn't open the gates and let all the rest go crazy. One person, well, we'd count again. We'd count again. But one person would go find the lost sheep. This says something about the radical, this parable, the radical nature of God. Because every sheep matters. Just like that lost coin. It matters. They don't say, hey, they were pleased that the sheep was found, the coin was found. No! The sentence is, rejoice with me. When's the last time you had a friend, family member, neighbor say, rejoice with me? Please, rejoice with me. Probably not, maybe ever, unless your friends, family, neighbors are regularly using language like rejoice. Rejoice is kind of a church word, right? Rejoice! It's a huge word in the Bible because it speaks of being filled with joy, wonder, happiness. Rejoice with me. And we all know our good shepherd doesn't need to leave the 99 to find the one, because our good shepherd already knows where everybody is. God knows. And we can take great consolation from that. God tells everything about us and still chooses to call us beloved. That's something to rejoice over. The theme among all of our lessons, though, today is about having a change of heart, a change of mind. In this gospel from Luke, the rejoicing is because one sinner has repented. There might be 99 that haven't done too much too terribly, but one recognized something was wrong, something was out of place. They were. And repented. Changed direction is the word for repent. It's a literal walking away from. And you probably, most of you have heard me say this before. Okay, repent is, I'm walking down the street, I'm walking towards stuff that's not good for my neighbor and not going to help me with God. I'm walking down this way. And there is a realization that this isn't right. To repent is to walk the other way. Back toward my neighbor. Back toward God. Psalm 51. Many of our churches of origin used to sing every single Sunday, because it was in the liturgy, create in me a clean heart, O God. This was by tradition, this was David's psalm when he turned away from his sin of killing Bathsheba's husband and taking Bathsheba for himself. Have mercy on me, O God. Wash me through and through from my wickedness and cleanse me from my sin. And sometimes we do need to take a beat and recognize our sin. And as Chris was talking about, sometimes you see it on TV. like somebody goes into a confessional, bless me, Father, for I have sinned. And then they list all the stuff and all the thoughts they had during the week that they think God might not be too happy with. That's a part of confession. But another part of confession, and this is something that Chris talked about, is recognizing when we've been part of a corporate sin. And by corporate, I mean people, everybody, most people, lots of people participate because it's built into the system. Or everybody's doing it. So as the world pauses to remember the life of Queen Elizabeth, there are also many people who are raising up the issues of the corporate sins of the leadership of Great Britain, colonialism. That was one of the things our church-wide assembly talked about. There's a hashtag called decolonize. If you're one of the people that does social media, look up hashtag decolonialize. Corporate sin. All of our school textbooks say Columbus discovered America. And magically, there was all this land, and it was free for the taking. I grew up believing that. But it was corporate sin, and it started at the church. They said, if someone's on the land and they're not Christians, you can have it. It's yours. Corporate sin excludes others. Look up the cartoon artist David Hayward sometime. He does lots of line drawing cartoons about this issue. How people get excluded, and even from sometimes from the church, because of something perceived. Corporately. Like everybody's thinking this, so it must be right. I worked at a church once that still thought black people should be under the balcony if they do show up. By the way, the ELCA is the whitest church in America. ELCA and Southern Baptists, we're working on that, Chris. But we have to name what it is we're working on, okay? Most churches will say everyone is welcome. All are welcome. Everybody's welcome. But there's some kind of fine print in most churches too. This used to be a church that had fine print that said, if you are dressed well, right? If you were wearing the right clothes, if you didn't have the right clothes, this wasn't the place for you. That's not true anymore. But we need, this is about corporate sin. We need to recognize the things that we gloss over ourselves. Like, we can say everybody's welcome at my church, but every church does that. How about we lean into it even a little further? And instead of saying all are welcome, we say we are committed to inclusion. How's that ring? We are committed to inclusion. That as a church body, we are committed to inclusion. this, and this. But that we are all committed to seeing all of God's other children as God's other children. What if we are committed to justice? The Bible has been mistranslated. And translation is a complicated issue because how many of you have studied a second language at all? Most of you. Yeah. So you know that one word can have several meanings in both languages. And so you take a word in English, you try to place it on top of a word in another language, but the English word has several different meanings. And the word in the other language has several different meanings. You could be entirely off because you picked the wrong word. But when scholars do it with something as important as the Bible, people can get wounded, seriously wounded. What other words, Chris, are justice in English Bibles? What do we use besides justice? Sometimes loving kindness. You know, sometimes other nice words. But justice is at the heart of what God is about, what Jesus was about. Micah, right? What does the Lord require of us? Actually, if you go to the Old Testament prophet Micah, it's a short book. And before the prophet says, what does the Lord require of us? He lambasts the people with what the Lord does not like. And the prophets even are very direct in their words. Very direct. They hate arrogance. They hate God hates the rich taking advantage of the poor. We're going to talk about this next Sunday if you're able to come after worship. But do you know the Bible? Every seventh year was a year of Jubilee when all debts were canceled. We have a corporate sin that owns us. America is in debt. God is about justice. And so what does the Lord require, asks Micah. Do justice. Love kindness. And walk humbly with your God. You'll hear a lot of things from a lot of people about what God requires. But the people who are the loudest at spouting those things will never say justice, kindness, humbleness. It's a good day to repent from our own participation and things that make us look at others who are created in the image of God and think less of them. It's a good day to remember 9/11. And the violent aftermath. It's a good day to think about war everywhere. What are these wars solving? Are they about justice? Kindness? Walking humbly with God? It's a good day to repent. It's also a good day to recommit. To recommit to the only true source of our hope. To the life, the death, and the resurrection of Jesus Christ. We are church, individually baptized members of God's flock. We own that. That's our identity. Look around yourself and see the other people in this room. Have you argued with them this week? Have you said something about them this week? Each one of us so much. Can we commit to being more Christ-like? Commit to justice and kindness and humbleness and justice again and inclusion. Yes, we can. By the grace of God. By the grace of God. Peace of Christ that passes all understanding will keep our hearts and minds in Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen.
Thank you.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
The prayers of intercession are found on page 7 of the bulletin. As scattered grains of wheat are gathered together into one bread, so let us gather our prayers for the church, those in need, and all of God's good creation. Your people receive mercy, and your grace overflows in our lives. Fill your church with faith and love, and give understanding hearts to those who work to strengthen our ecumenical and interreligious commitments. God of grace, hear our prayer. Your creation groans as it suffers the impacts of pollution and lack of care. As the seasons change, renew in us the will to protect plants, animals, and habitats. Bless us with bountiful harvests that all may share. God of grace, hear our prayer. Your world is shattered in the nations' rage. Remember us in your mercy. Teach wisdom to our elected leaders so that we know peace in our world, peace in our homes, and peace in our hearts. God of grace, hear our prayer. Your children wander homeless and the hungry cry for bread. Seek out those who are lost or lonely, anxious or depressed, struggling with addiction or illness, especially Sarah, Geraldine, and Vince's mom. Provide for those in any need. God of grace, hear our prayer. Your work is done in this congregation with our hands, feet, voices, minds, and hearts. Build up the ministries of this community that we serve our neighbors and welcome the stranger in your name. God of grace, hear our prayer. Your blessed saints who have died now rest in your presence. Give us thankful hearts for those who have been examples of faith in our lives. And receive us with joy when we come to share eternal life with you, especially coming. God of grace,
hear our prayer.
As we remember the events of 9/11, we pray, O God, that where hearts were fearful and constricted, you would grant courage and hope. Where anxiety is infectious and widening, grant peace and reassurance. Where impossibilities close every door and window, grant imagination and resistance. Where distrust twists our thinking, grant healing and illumination. Where spirits are daunted and weakened, grant soaring wings and strengthened dreams. Forgive us for our words and actions that are contrary to your way and will. Gathered together in the sweet communion of the Holy Spirit, gracious God, we offer these and all our prayers to you. Through Jesus Christ our Savior. Amen.
We also lift up Jackson Albright, who's recovering, and ask your grace to be with us all. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
The peace of Christ be with you all.
And also with you.
Thank you.
and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ, who finds the lost sheep, who knows where we are, and who on this day overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. And so with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join your unending hymn. No, it's just one bell.
No, I mean all of Galesburg.
Courthouse and the Mass College, I think.
Yes,
are the only other bells.
Three working bells or previously working bells in Galesburg, so we'd like to get that running again.
All right. If you could, we're asking adults to stick around as well as our young folks to help pack up Lutheran World Relief kits. Cindy and Connie. And
Judy.
wearing God's Work Our Hands shirts. Laid out everything on the tables so they can give you instructions to just pick up one of everything and put it in a bag. We are grateful to all of you that we raised all of the supplies that we need to make 100 school kits. And so now we're just going to pack them up so we can ship them out. God's Work Our Hands Days. We will be placing another God's Work Our Hands shirt order soon. I'm just working on pricing. So if you'd like one of those, drop us a note in the office and we'll get the prices to you as soon as they're solid. Bob, did you have a word?
Yes. Because the community room will be kind of busy, building and grounds, let's meet up in the memorial room.
Right, buildings and grounds is meeting after worship. Oh, if the if it's still raining or soggy out here, we're going to move the block party inside. And we'll have just as much fun, same food. But we'll be inside. We'll have board games. We'll have, you know, if you want to bring your favorite game or something, please do. And if you're, okay, I'm an introvert. And I don't go to a lot of stuff. If you're having those kinds of feelings, I'm especially inviting you. This is our really one big annual opportunity to get together and have conversations and fun and food and just kind of, you know, socialize outside of worship. So please, I hope you can come back. Did I miss anything? All right, please be blessed. God, who gives life to all things and frees us from despair, bless you with truth and peace. And may the Holy Trinity, one God, guide you always in faith, hope, and love. Amen.
Go in peace with Christ beside you.
Thanks be to God.